As a start, you know, take us through the reasons that were given by the initial court to declare Section 18 of the Constitution of the Criminal Procedure Act unconstitutional. I see now that the Constitutional Court has then verified this as saying that it is correct, that it is unconstitutional. Take us through the reasons given. I saw the word irrational. I saw the word arbitrary. But really, what was the gist of that resolution?
As you know, our new constitution of 1996, which started operating in February, on February the 4th, 1997, really tried to make it impossible, or rather to illegal, invalid for the state to be able to have past capital punishment. In other words, it was removed. But it wasn't removed directly in the Constitution. It was really removed by a Constitutional Court ruling under the interim Constitution, which was 1990, which we used from 1994 to February 1997. Now, the idea, the reasons which were given then was that capital punishment does not solve much, and it is not up to the state to be able to kill people who kill or who rape or who does other forms of very, very serious offenses. Section 18 of the Criminal Procedure Act deals with the question of prescription, as right. we call it in law, which means that...
An expiry of sorts.
Yeah, a period if any prosecution is not done within that period, then... no prosecution can take place. Prescription is a terrible concept at law, because I think that if you are dealing with serious matters, even when it is questions of land, questions of not just the crime of murder, rape, and so on, sexual assault, if you say after a period, then you cannot be able to be punished for the wrong that you have done, then we are dealing with a very difficult situation, because then you are blocking justice from being done based on prescription when some of the crimes, new evidence can emerge. Yeah. At any time, the question is, do you have sufficient valid evidence that can be proved beyond reasonable doubt that you did commit the offense, if it is a criminal matter?
And in fact, Prof, I'd like to play devil's advocate now.
Sure.
You know, when it comes to these alleged perpetrators. What's the balance then between the right, of course, of the victim to get heard by a court even after 20 years that the incident has happened, but also the constitutional right of that alleged perpetrator? Because there are instances, and you would have heard some of the more, I suppose, the bigger cases that have been happening, playing out in the media, where some of these powerful men, these wealthy men, for example, your Harvey Weinstein, and your Bill Cosby's, and even here in South Africa, we have a situation involving Danny Jordan, who have said, I am being blackmailed. People are trying to get money out of me, or getting certain things out of me. And that's why I'm being accused of something that happened 20 years ago. So how do we balance, you know, the rights of the person that is obviously aggrieved, or the person that alleges that an assault happened or a rape happened, and then on the back of that, the person who might, in some instances, be incorrectly accused of the crime though that happened over 20 years ago. And that also raises the question then of evidence, the proof of evidence, and how it's balanced out after such a long time that the case has passed. And I suppose that's why there was that Section 8 clause of prescription, if I can put it that way. And as I say, I'm just playing devil's advocate at this point.
Yeah, I think it is balancing. Here you have somebody who was hurt, wronged. There is the right to humanity, to human dignity, as it were. There's a right in the Constitution that one should not be subjected to psychological or physical abuse. Security of the person is sacrosanct. And if you look at it from that point of view, then you say there may have been a reason. It is up to the person who is really saying they want prosecution after that period of 20 years or so to provide credible evidence.
Right.
And you can. You can, because you will indicate where did it take place. It can be checked. Were you at that place on that day? Mm. Was the person who is going to be prosecuted there on that day? Mm-hmm. And so on. And why didn't you at that time really push for prosecution? And you can say, well, I was hurt. Maybe sometimes it is a relative. Mm. And it makes it very difficult. But one day you may say, no, I want to die in peace, to be able to actually say what happened.
Yeah.
Just that itself is cathartic. It really helps you to heal rather than die with this hatred and pain without sharing it. Because also, actually, coming out in the open is it in itself very painful.
You know, I'd like to ask you, you know, the Frankel 8 case is what essentially changed the situation here.
Yes.
What was so different about this particular case which made the High Court go, well, hold on a minute, there's something wrong with this particular section of the Criminal Procedure Act, and then even further for the Constitutional Court to then agree and verify that the High Court was correct in its decision? And of course now we know that it's going to go to Parliament for it to be amended. I mean, what was so strong about this particular case? And I can imagine many people have probably gone to the courts wanting their sexual assault cases resolved and turned back because of this issue of prescription.
Yeah.
So I'd like to know what exactly made this case so different to any other, to the point that it could change really the game.
Well, the courage of the victim,
yeah,
or the alleged victim, to come out after that long and to be able to stand strong and say, I can provide evidence to that. As you said, there are other persons, not just this particular case you mentioned, Bill Cosby. Some have claimed President of the U.S.
Right.
also did that, and so on. These were powerful people who could maybe be in a position even to harm you further by hiring people to eliminate you and so on. Mm. So the fact that you come out in itself, very difficult indeed, and the fact that you are coming out and so on, and evidence is found that this actually took place, if there is. So the court is right. There are many sections of the Criminal Procedure Act and Criminal Law and Procedure Act and many other laws which are not necessarily of a criminal nature, where the courts have ruled that those sections of whatever, if it is a Criminal Procedure Act and so on and so forth, are really unlawful and unconstitutional. But also in civil matters, because it can be a civil matter.
Just in closing, Prof, you know, what I see is a situation where one section of the Criminal Procedure Act is now having to be amended. But this works as a domino effect, doesn't it? So at some point, somewhere, other parts or sections of the Act itself will then also have to be amended because this Act has been amended. I mean, this is quite a tedious task, isn't it?
Yeah, you are right. But we always have to improve on the laws we have so that we deepen justice.
Right.
Justice is seen to be done. And we don't just talk about justice and so on, but it has to be seen to be done.
Yeah.
So I think that, to me, is important. It doesn't matter which other sections will require also being amended.
Mm.
And if that were the case, and to improve the system and to deepen justice in society, so be it. Why not? Because we make the law. Or rather, it is made by Parliament after it is proposed by the executive in most cases. And we can do the same.
All right, Prof, it's been a great pleasure having you in studio with us. And I am taking you up on the offer you've made this morning to help me with my master's. I'm struggling. All right. Thank you very much.
No, that is important. Young people like you. You should study.
Yeah, you
should
study. Thank you very much. We appreciate having you in studio with us.
Thank you.
You can stay seated. Thank you so very much.